so you're both abstract, you're not. Yeah. Any problems with that? Yes. Well, reincarnation. Yeah, that's what he's saying. I mean, well, he's not saying it happens, but he's saying, tell me a bit more about reincarnation, actually. What's reincarnation? Yeah, right. That's a key thing. The same person abstractly puts it very well. It's not the same soul, it's not the same body, but you could be the same person. Yeah. He's saying that makes perfect sense. Yeah. He's not saying it happens, but he's saying it's not a contradiction. Yep. Would philosophy one of the substances? No. I think in this picture, if you take the identity of a computer file, right, you can talk about moving a file from one disk to another. Yeah, I got it in this disk, now I move the file to that disk, now I move the file to that disk. There's nothing physical in common between the three disks. But that doesn't mean that you should be a dualist about computer files and say, oh, well, actually, computer files relate to another stratum of reality than ordinary physics. You see what I mean? It's just an abstract kind of principle of organization of the physical that's being moved from place to place. Computer files are just kind of abstract, but they're not non-physical, but they can't be identified with any particular physical thing either. Yeah. So thoughts are like that too. The thoughts of a person would be like that too. You can move a file around, you can move a thought around. Yeah, all the thoughts that used to be in this brain are now in that brain. Sure, they can be generated by specific bits of brain, that's right. Well, just do it the way we would with a computer. I mean, if you generate a computer file, you do it by particular keystrokes, and you do it by the electricity being generated in some particular, well, I don't really know what they are, but chips or something. Yeah. So there's some specific electrical activity involved in generating the file. But then you can move the file from place to place. Yeah. That's the way it goes. Yeah. These are kind of abstract configurations of the physical. And that's who you are. That's how you can print it off. Okay. So on Monday, we'll look more at why this all matters, why this is important. But today, I just want to look a little bit more about what the idea is here, what we mean when we're talking about memory. So what we're saying is transfer of memories between the body of the prince and the body of the cobbler would mean that the people had swapped bodies. Transfer of memories between the soul of the prince and the soul of the cobbler would mean that people had swapped souls. Now, as already came up, someone was talking about muscle memory. People talk about procedural or habit memory. Like, if you remember how to ride a bicycle, or you remember how to play the piano, yeah, you remember how to sing a song, how to make tea. That's one kind of memory. Another kind of memory, Martin and Deutscher, that we were looking at last time, talked about these kind of distinctions. There's propositional memory. They're just remembering that the Battle of Hastings was in 1066, that Benjamin Franklin invented bifocals, all these memories you can have of particular facts. And then there's your memory of particular past events, autobiographical or episodic memory, where you remember the highs and lows of your own past life. I mean, what's your hunch? Which of these is going to be more important for the identity of the self? Can you get your hand up if you would make it procedural memory? If you would make it propositional memory? If you make it autobiographical or episodic memory? Yeah, I think, yeah, very good. That's the usual answer given in the books. I guess one way to put it is that you can make perfect sense of losing procedural or habit memories for staying the same person, losing propositional memories. I can't remember all these dates now, but it's still the same person. But remembering a particular incident, that seems specific, idiosyncratic to you. That's what's making you the person you are. So Locke's definition is a person is an intelligent, thinking intelligent being that has reason and reflection and consider itself as itself. You can think of yourself as yourself, one and the same person in different times and places. But there's something special about the way you know your own past life. I mean, after all, if you're writing a biography of someone's life or if you just have a friend you've had for a long time, you can know their past life as pretty much as well as you know your own. But there's that direct memory you have of your own past life. And one way to think of it is, it's imagistic. You have a kind of imaginative understanding of your own past life that you don't have of anyone else's. Another way to think of it is, you can tell the story of your own past life in a way you can't tell the story of anyone else's. You can think of memory as an exercise of the imagination. You can use imagination in knowing your own past life. Just as we were talking about Laurie Paul, we were talking about your imaginative understanding of your future life. You can think of memory as your imagination running backwards into allowing you to relive your own past life. So what is memory? Okay, so this is kind of connecting up with the stuff we did last time, that if you're going to remember a particular past event, then you have to have a current impression of the past event. If you're going to remember how the window was in your childhood bedroom, then you have to have some kind of sense of what that window was like. And moreover, the window had to have been like that, the way you remember it to be, if you see what I mean. So if you've got those two pieces, is that enough for memory? So when you take that example of remembering the window that you had in your bedroom when you were a child, do that now, can you remember it? Put up your hand if you remember the window in your childhood bedroom. Okay, this is a good exercise to do. Okay, so you've got a current impression of that, and suppose the window was indeed just the way you remember it. Are those two pieces there, is that enough for it to be memory? Put up your hand if the answer is yes. And if the answer is no, well, no is the right answer, or at any rate, no is the recommended answer. The guy who said yes, you're right that these two pieces are critical. If you've got no impression at all right now, you just can't bring it to mind. And that's an argument for saying you don't remember it. And if you've got an impression right now as to how it was back then, but the window was actually nothing like that, then that also means you don't remember it. But if it was that way, and you do have that impression, that's enough for you to remember it. That's the idea. But that's not true. I mean, suppose this is the window in your childhood bedroom. Right? Right? Something like that. Yeah? No? Everybody's going to know that. It was a bit like that. Anyway, glossing lightly over that. Suppose you're discussing this with, say, your brother or sister or parent or friend or something, and they're saying to you, you don't remember the window, and they say to you, don't you remember? It looked like this. It was shaped like the wheel of a ship with spokes coming out from the center. So you now have an image in your head of the past window. And let's suppose that the information you're getting is correct. It was like that. Do you remember? Can you now be said to be remembering the past window? Put up your hand if the answer is yes. And if the answer is no? Of course not. They just told you. You don't remember it at all. You just saw a picture. Yep. Prompting. Yes, it is prompting. That's right. This is prompting. It could result in memory. But the point is, at this stage, it hasn't yet generated memory. Yep. So the question is, what would have to happen for it to generate a memory? You got an impression. You're at this stage. You already have an impression. And it's a correct impression. The past window was that way. So what more do you need? This is what we did last time. This is one of these pedagogically rewarding moments, right? Yes? You need to come up with a detail that wasn't mentioned in the prompt. That's great. That's a really natural idea. I don't think it could be right, because remember that thing about the magnificent bird that we were talking about last time? It could be that you show me pictures, you tell me all the story of this window in such a way that the prompt is so full that there's nothing left for me to fill in. But there's still something more I've got to do in order to remember. Yep. Do you need to actually see it? Yeah. It's an interesting idea. Oh, and in practice, that might often work. But the thing is, even if you see it again, right? Suppose this conversation is happening, just as you and I are at the dear old house, yeah? And you say, and I say, no, I just can't remember. I can visualize it perfectly well. And we go around the corner, and by God, there it is, right? Well, all that might happen is that I now see it. And I see it completely matches the way you told me it was. And I know that that's the way it was back then. But I still don't remember. I don't remember how it was back then. I don't remember the window. Yeah, I mean, that seems possible. Yeah, yeah. It's really hard to see how that could not be memory. But the key question is why? You're just filling in some more details there, but the person who's prompting you could have filled in the details. You see what I mean? So if it's just a matter of getting more details, then that can't be the right answer, because you can get them more details without it being memory. Yeah? It occurred to me. Yeah. Yeah, it's something to do with the way the image is coming to you. Yeah. If it's coming to you entirely from the other person, then that's not memory. Yeah? Yeah, that one, of course, yes, now I remember. Yeah, you can do it later without prompting here. Yeah, as you get older, sometimes you can't ever get stuff without being prompted. You know, every time we go over this, I have to ask you to remind me. Just, you know, what is his name? What was he wearing? Yeah, yeah. 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 Yes. Right. Yeah. Yes. Right. Yeah. Yes. That's very good. Okay, so the way, you're right, I guess I am posing it like a practical question, how you get a memory out of the situation, and everything you guys are saying makes perfect sense there. I mean, it might also be that if you just clump around the ear would do it, you know, just, that'll help you remember. But the question is, what's the difference when you do remember? What's the key difference? Yeah. Yes. Right, there's something internal about what has to happen for it really to be memory. Yeah, I think that's very good. There's something internal going on for you to remember, and it's not just a matter of being able to put out the right kind of public show, because in this kind of case, I could put out the right kind of public show, but there's something internal that's missing. That's your point. Yeah, no, I think that's absolutely right. Yeah. Something scientifically triggering inside the brain. Yes. Yeah. Bingo. That's really what Martin and Deutscher were saying, right? There's going to be a trace in your brain that's getting activated. Yeah? It's all come back to you. Right, now we remember, right? So the way Martin and Deutscher were putting it is, if you, this thing about being internal, if you're telling me about the window back then, so there's the way the window was back then, there's the window back then, and there's my impression of it now, and it's not just that I'm getting it right now, it's that the way the window was is what's causing me to have this impression. I have that impression as to how it was because that's the way it was with the window back then. That can't be the whole story because if you're telling me, it might be that if you're reliable, what you'll be doing is you saw the window back then, and that caused you to tell me how it is now. So we want a causal connection that, as someone said, is internal. It's something inside me. And that's what Antonio was saying about, or talking about things occurring to you. It's what's triggering it. You want this stuff that's prompting to trigger something inside you for it to be a memory. And if that happens, then it can be said to be truly remembering. It's not just, it's the memory trace is the key thing. So this is really what you're all about. Memories have to do with memory traces. It's memory when a trace that's been laid down in your brain earlier is being activated now. Yep. A red wristband. Yes, just to take a few hypothetical example, yeah. Right. Right. Yeah, okay. Oh, yeah, you could be remembering it wrong. Yeah. 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 I guess there are just lots and lots of different cases here. I mean, suppose you remembered it, and it wasn't, you might say in that case, yeah, no, I know what car you're talking about, but it wasn't blue, it was red, and it was a race car or a police car. Yeah. But if it goes too far, it wasn't even a car, it was a train. It wasn't even a train, it was a car mechanic's outfit. Yeah, it was actually a small dog. you can only be so far wrong. Yeah, I think it depends. There are just cases and cases. It depends what's important in the context. Yeah. Ah, right, there's a trace there. Yeah. Yeah. I do think, I think that's really important, actually. It's important in everyday life. You know, of course I remember you, Anna. Nice to see you. Yeah. Let's say you work in sales. No. I'm an nurse. And so on. Yeah, there's a point where you say, do I remember this person or not? Okay, so the key thing is that anyhow, whatever exactly you say about these cases, when you say, aha, now I remember, the image might be the same as before, but then it's a trace that's being activated inside you, not the prompting that's doing the causing. So the thing is, we began with the idea that the notion of the self is very abstract, is not a concrete thing. The self has to, the sameness of the self has to do with the sameness of memories, but now it looks like memory requires the sameness of the concrete trace. Yeah? So you can't be all that abstract. So thinking that through is, I guess, the homework for next time. Okay, thanks guys, great questions, great comments. Yeah. Next time we'll talk about why all this is important.